power even to deal with it. Maybe we don't even have local capacity. So first of all, the conviction you have to be able to attract this kind of individual is that you are able to build a system of economic that can ensure when they bring their money, it can go out and they can price in the risk of volatility of your exchange rate more reasonably into what happens in the next 2, 3, 4 years that they are locked in. Take for instance now, we are in the news, $700 million worth of airlines earnings is locked in Nigerian economy that cannot go out from those top airlines. Right now, if you want to pay for your airline bill, they're saying, go buy a dollar, come and pay through agency before you pay. So we're not collecting. Many of them are moving out because they can't even move the dollar they have earned in Nigeria out. CBN says, go and I'm not giving you dollar at official exchange. Go and I'm not exchanging for you. Go and find a place to deal with it. So that's one problem. So if you move to power now, I've argued this government have, I'm trying to be careful, is this government, when they were campaigning, what we understood was that they are immediately going to technically de-emphasize the national grid and allow the states and communities to go and make power available for their people. I also argue, I don't have this statistic very factually, that compared to the 7,000 megawatt the claim exists right now in terms of generating capacities that they know, we could possibly have a lot more than that, because I know Port Harcourt, River State had his own power plant that cannot be evacuated right now. Akwa Ibom has. Lagos has a lot of generating capacities that they are using. Yeah. All of this, if we break down the rules, like Mr. Idahosa mentioned in relation to rails, if we break down the rules and allow state to go and generate the power and feed its own people, you will be surprised at the extent of power that we'll be able to get. Most of the examples that he cited in other communities, you'll find a situation where in an average town of 200,000, 400,000, 500,000 people, they have a power generating plant and a grid that just takes care of them. That's why you see the amount of power you see in New York City that is bigger than the whole that we are using in Africa. So, first of all, we need to first of all design, and it's just simple market, it's simple economy. You're not going to run a centralized economy and expect a result that a market economy will.
But do you think government is afraid of a hijack of the system if they open up that power sector to local investors?
It's a cat and horse situation we find ourselves in, and one just needs to move first. Maybe here is the situation. A lot of time, maybe because of the way we've moved over the years and the kind of experience and things that has happened, we've not allowed the people who get into power have always been skeptical about just playing a minimal role of government, which is simply regulation. In every sector of the economy, you find this. Look at education, for instance. There's no reason government should be running universities. Government should regulate the quality of education that a university should churn out. If you want to make sure that your students have free education, give them bursary, give them grant, give them scholarship. That's the way it works. Let the university run with standard. Every student will decide, I want to go to the University of Ibadan because they give me standard. Then the government will support him to pay the bill that University of Ibadan is charging to be able to attain that standard. Then the university can run properly. The same thing with power, the same thing with petroleum, oil and gas, on this, the same thing with agriculture, the same thing with. So the simple thing the government needs to do is to simply go back and play the simple role of a regulator. Stay there. Look at, for instance, now if you look at in the Niger Delta, we produce, you have a lot of people we now demonize as bunkers who produce illegal refineries. Those people should not be criminalized. We should simply create a regulator, NAFDAC like, and then certify these guys, sell oil to them, let them produce.
Make sure that they produce the right quantity
and the quality. So it means that when we say every day that we want to continue to import refined petroleum from them, when we actually have people producing this right behind our doors, what does that look like? This is okay. The same thing that is happening in all the sectors of the economy.
We got to start winding down now. So, what way forward for the economy so that we'll stop this bleeding that he has spoken about, loss of jobs, manufacturing companies folding up, I mean, all these we have to reverse. Otherwise, our economy is, we're just talking. Mm. So how do we achieve all that?
Well, I think the most urgent thing, perhaps, is to close the gap between talking and acting. I think that's really critical. You can't say in the government there's lack of information or lack of knowledge of what is right.
Actions, not words.
Yes. In the government, you have in the civil service very knowledgeable people who know exactly what to do. But between knowing what to do, convincing their political heads of various agencies, and then the head of the agency convincing the presidency, it's like a marathon. And that is where the problem is. Most of the things we are discussing, they are aware that they need to be done. But a top civil servant will tell you, well, for this to be done, it has to go through 75 steps.
We have given them the document.
One memo has to go to one memo, and somebody has to listen. And so everything just grinds to a very, very slow, and sometimes just grinds to a halt. So rather than new prescriptions, if the government can just have a much higher sense of urgency, that's really what you can ask for. They know most of what we're saying. But a minister wants to move, he said, before I move, somebody else has to move. That somebody else says, I cannot move because the other person has to move. Mm. The president says, I can't move because I need a memo from ESCO. ESCO says they can't wait because somebody else has to do a committee, or the white paper committee has to finish their own before we do
set
that.
Set up another committee and to look at what the white paper committee has done.
9 months is gone. We are where we were when we started.
Mr. Ndimugi. Yes, your parting shot.
Just like what Mr. Dawsa said, I think the government should spend more time now to see how what analysts, various economists, what they've advised in the last 11 months. And let's see action. There are more than enough smart guys in the ministries. But I think we need, this is a time when all the talk, we need to put them into action.
That's okay. Mr. Dorodola.
Thanks. And I think we first of all need to move very quickly on the foreign exchange situation. It's one major hangover. One hangover too many for the economy right now. I've always argued that everything that the president has in mind in terms of supporting essential commodities, supporting different sectors of the economy that is dear to his heart, agriculture, solid mineral, can be done within a flotation of the currency. Because you can float the currency and let everybody else take the high bite, while the sector you want to support can be supported from the supply side. Okay. When we do that, a lot of other things will
fall into place. Thank you very much. We have been chatting with economists, Gabriel Idahosa and Debayo Durodola, as well as development finance expert Mr. Ayodeji Onibugi. Thank you all for coming to share your insights with us this morning. Sunrise will be back in just a moment with the home stretch. See you in just a moment.